Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
This is Mallika Pathak from Miranda House University of Delhi, starting with a course on solid state for the students of BSc Honours Chemistry and BSc with Chemistry. This is Module 5, Lecture 1 of the series. The academic expert of the course is Dr. Amrita T. Sheikh, and the recording is being done under the DTH Swayam Prabha project of the MHRD New Delhi. Today, we are starting with solid state. So, for this, we will start with an introduction to solids. We'll talk about crystallography, followed by a discussion on various types of crystal structures. What is a unit cell? What are the various kinds of Bruys lattices? How do we calculate the number of atoms per unit cell? So let's start. So till now, we have talked about gases and liquids. Gas is that physical state of matter in which the molecules are very, very far apart from each other. This large intermolecular distance is because of the fact that they have very weak intermolecular forces, because of which they are highly compressible in nature. Now, in the case of liquids, there is a chaos, but the forces are stronger. So the molecules are much closer as compared to that in the gases. And therefore, the density is slightly higher than that in the case of gases. And you can see that the density and the flow is there as compared to that in the gases that we were talking about earlier. But what happens in the case of solids? In the case of solids, there is a very, very strong intermolecular force of attraction between the molecules, because of which the molecules, the constituent molecules or the constituent particles are held closely together in their respective positions, making it a rigid structure. This rigidity of the structure has come because there are strong intermolecular forces which are keeping these molecules fixed to their positions. There is that rigidity, and because of that, there is a shape. Obviously, because the intermolecular distance between the molecules is very, very small, and there is strong intermolecular forces. Therefore, they are also highly incompressible in nature. So, whereas gases were highly compressible, solids are highly incompressible. And that is because of the fact that the intermolecular forces are increasing as we move from gases to the liquids to the solids. And the randomness decreases. So, in the case of gases, the randomness was very, very high. The liquids, there is some randomness, but there is a flow which has come. So some sort of ordering has taken place. And in the case of solids, there is no flow. There is a rigid structure, rigid shape, and all because of the fact that the intermolecular forces are very strong, which results in molecules being fixed to their positions. The intermolecular distance has decreased, and therefore they have also become highly incompressible in nature. Now, there are two kinds of solids that we talk about. So generally, when we talk about solids, we actually talk about crystalline solids. But actually, there are two kinds of solids. And the first kind is a crystalline solid. The crystalline solids are those in which there is an ordered arrangement of constituent particles for a very, very long distance. And in the case of amorphous, there is an ordered arrangement. But that ordered arrangement is only for a very, very short distance or short distance. So this structure that we are talking about, crystalline and amorphous, we tend to, in the normal day-to-day life, we take them interchangeably, but they are not. The crystalline solids, when we talk about, are those in which the constituent particles are fixed. And this ordered arrangement is followed for a very long distance. And that is what is called as long range order. And this is because of the fact the intermolecular forces are very, very strong in nature. In the case of amorphous, either the arrangement is not regular, even for a very short distance. But even if the arrangement is there, it will not be followed for a very long distance. So there may be an arrangement which is there for some short distance, but this arrangement will not be followed throughout the structure, and that is why they are called as amorphous. So when we talk of plastics, when we talk of glass, they are come in the category of amorphous. When we talk of crystalline, we talk of sodium chloride structure, we talk of diamond structure, those are crystalline solids. So let's take the case of crystalline solids first. So what is a crystalline solid? Like I've already said, that it is a solid material in which the constituent particles, whether it is atom, molecules, ions, they are arranged in a pattern which is repeated and extended in all the spatial dimensions. So you have an arrangement of the constituent particles which is followed for a very, very long distance. So it is called as long range order. So this is characterized by a regular arrangement of atoms, molecules, or ions. Now there are two kinds of crystalline solids that we are going to talk about, and we talk about always non-metallic crystals and metallic crystals. So ice, carbon, diamonds, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, these are examples of non-metallic crystals. Whereas metallic crystals are copper, silver, aluminium, tungsten, magnesium. So all metals follow this metallic crystal category. So there is an arrangement which is followed by metals. Now, what are the properties of the crystalline solids? Now, as I have said, that the constituent particles have arranged themselves in a regular manner, which is repeated in all the directions. So there is a special arrangement of constituent particles, which is repeated in all the three directions, and it is a three-dimensional network which is there. So there is a lattice which is there. So lattice is nothing but a framework. So when you see a house, you know, so you see iron rods put in a house and they form a framework in which the bricks are put so that you have a house which is built up. So that framework is what is called as lattice. So there is a lattice which is there in a crystalline solid. And because there is strong intermolecular force, there are strong forces of attraction, therefore they have a definite geometrical shape. You will have flat faces, there will be sharp edges. So let's say these are the two flat faces. So they will join together at one end. So this will be called as an edge where the two faces join together. So that is a shape that is there because of the faces, because of the edges. And this arrangement is incompressible in nature because, as I have said already, there is a strong intermolecular force between the molecules, and therefore they are incompressible. That this force or this order is long range order, which is followed throughout. Because of this ordered arrangement, they would have definite sharp melting points. So you will know that this is a crystalline solid when it melts at a sharp melting point. So if it is saying a melting point of 1500 degrees centigrade, it will melt at 1500 degrees centigrade. It is going to be sharp melting point. It will start melting at 1500 and it will melt at only 1501. There is that range. There is no category. So it will not melt from 1500 to 1510. It will melt at one melting point. So when the melting starts till the melting finishes, there will be only 1500 degrees centigrade. There is one important property which is followed in the crystalline solids, and that is called as anisotropy. Now, what is anisotropy? That if you measure the refractive index, if you measure the electrical conductivity, if you measure the thermal conductivity, if you measure such properties, you will find that the values will be different in different direction. I can say that the values measured will give you different values when you measure in different direction. Why? Because, see, there is a crystalline structure. So in the structure, in some direction, there'll be more number of molecules. In some direction, there'll be less number of molecules because this is a crystalline structure. So imagine there is a cube and you have only 8 particles arranged at the corners. So in one direction, there can be only 2 molecules. In one direction, there can be no molecules. So if you measure the property in a direction, there are no molecules, then the value is going to be less. In a direction where there are going to be molecules, the property will change. So this anisotropy is due to the fact that the number of constituent particles are different in the different directions of the measurement. And therefore, the values that you will measure will give you different values measured in different directions. All this was because there was a definite geometry, and this definite geometry was there why? Because there was long range forces present in this crystalline structure, the molecules were fixed on their positions, and because of that there is a definite geometry. The geometry is because of the fact that there is a lattice. So one of the important characteristics is the forces. There are forces, and because of which all these properties are going to be there. So because of this arrangement of constituent particles, you will also see X-ray diffraction bands in the X-ray diffraction pattern of the crystalline solids. So the examples of the crystalline solids that we normally study in the class are sodium chloride, cesium chloride. These are the structures that we are going to study later in the lecture. Now let's talk about the amorphous solids. So amorphous solids are nothing but the non-crystallized solids. And what is the characteristic of non-crystalline solids? That they have a random arrangement of atoms. So sometimes there is going to be an arrangement of atoms that when you look at it, you will see that this is a solid which has a particular rigid structure and there is a definite pattern. Yes, there may be a definite pattern, there may be a regular arrangement, but that regular arrangement is going to be of a short range order. It is going to be there only for a very short distance, not like crystalline solids, where the arrangement of constituent particles is maintained throughout the crystalline solid. In the case of amorphous solids, either there is a random arrangement, or if there is an ordered arrangement, that ordered arrangement is going to be there for a very short distance, that is short range order. And therefore, you know, you will see that some crystalline solids, people tend to, when they are still not familiar with the solids, will say that this is a solid. And it has a particular definite arrangement. Yes, but that arrangement is not of the long range order. So that is why they are sometimes even called as supercooled liquids. So the examples include amorphous silicon, plastic, glasses, all these are called as amorphous solids. Now let's look at the properties of the amorphous solid. So it has been derived from the Greek word amorphe, meaning shapeless. So the characteristics when you talk about amorphosis, something which doesn't have a very particular shape. So all polymers, plastic, which doesn't have a definite fixed shape and can be compressed a little and are called as amorphous in nature. So theoretically, there should be no regular arrangement and there should be a somewhat haphazard arrangement. But if there is a regular arrangement, there is a strong possibility that the solids that you come across which are amorphous are going to have a particular arrangement, but that arrangement is not going to be of the long range order. So that is why they are called as non-crystalline solids or supercooled liquids. Now, how do you know that this is an amorphous solid and this is a crystalline solid? One of the major characteristics is that they have sharp melting points. The crystalline solids have a sharp melting point, whereas the amorphous solids do not have a sharp melting point and they will melt over any range. So when I give you an example of 1500 degrees centigrade for a crystalline solid, it will melt at 1500 degrees centigrade, and when all the melting has taken place, the temperature is 1501. Whereas in the case of amorphous solid, when you try and melt them, they will melt over a range. So a range of 10 degrees centigrade, a range of 50 degrees centigrade, a range of 15 degrees centigrade, whatever. Some solids will start melting and they're slowly melting, and the temperature keeps on changing at which they are melting. So they do not have a sharp melting point. Now, one thing that I talked about in the crystalline solid was that they were anisotropic in nature. That is, if you measure certain properties like refractive index, conductivities, whether it is electrical conductivity, thermal conductivity, then you will find that they had different values when you measure in different direction. In the case of amorphous solids, the values will come out to be same when you measure in different directions. So this property is called as isotropic. So when you measure these properties like refractive index, conductivities, etc., in different directions, in the case of amorphous solids, you will get the same value when measured in different direction. And why is that happening? Because in the case of crystalline solids, the number of atoms or molecules were different in different directions, right? Whereas in the case of amorphous solid, the structure is such that when you measure these properties, you will find that the number of atoms in all the directions is same. And so the value of the properties are same. And when I'm saying atoms, it can be molecules, it can be different constituent particles. Now, because we are talking about amorphous solver, therefore there is no definite geometrical shape. You might say that I've given you an example of glass, and glass has a definite shape. Yes, it has a definite shape, but the shape is not maintained throughout. In fact, when you go to old houses or houses which have been built very early on, you will see that the sometimes, you know, you are not able to move the glasses in the channels that are present in which the glasses are there, because you will see that the glasses are thickened at the bottom. There is a thickening of glasses at the bottom because they are nothing but super cool liquids. So over a period of time, the glass may look very stable and look somewhat ordered and very fixed solid structure. But if you see it over the period of years, it tends to drain, and there is a thickening at the base which takes place, and because of which, when you try and move the glass of the windows in the channels, you will see that it is not moving because the glass at the bottom has thickened. And this has happened because it has a property which is a flowing kind of property. It doesn't have a geometrical shape which is very, very fixed, because the forces are not as strong as that in the crystalline solids. Now, because of all this nature, they do not give X-ray diffraction bands when you see. So a crystal structure can be very, very easily verified if it doesn't have a sharp melting, will be verified if it has a sharp melting point, it's a crystalline solid. If it doesn't have a sharp melting point, it is an amorphous solid. If the value of the properties measured are same in all direction, it is amorphous. If it is different in all direction, it is anisotropic, and therefore it is a crystalline solid. And diffraction band. So if there is a diffraction band which is observed in a solid, it is a crystalline solid. If you do not observe a diffraction band, extra diffraction band, then it is an amorphous solid. So examples we have already discussed are glass, rubber, and plastics. It is important to know that the distinction between the crystalline and the amorphous solids is not absolute. What I mean is that when you see a amorphous solid, you may see some sort of crystalline structure in them. So when you examine them by X-ray methods, the amorphous solids are also found to possess definite crystal lattices. Therefore, from the viewpoint of internal structure, the solids are essentially crystalline, that is, they are aggregates of very small crystals packed together in a more or less random fashion. Thus, solid state refers to a crystalline state. Strictly speaking, only a crystalline material can be considered as a true solid. Now, let's start an in-depth look at the crystals and the crystalline substances. But before we do that, let's define a term called as crystallography. So, crystallography is defined as the branch of science which deals with the study of geometry, properties and structure of crystals and crystalline substances. Now, how do we define a crystal? What is a crystal? So, a crystal may be defined as the homogeneous portion of a solid having a very regular structure bounded by a plane face which makes definite angles with each other and have a typical and distinctive symmetry and geometrical form characteristic of the solid substance. Now, this is the illustrative example of a crystal. Diamond is a crystal. Gems are a crystal. So, how do you know what is a crystal? A crystal is a substance which has plane faces. So, you can see that there is a face which is plane in nature. And these plane faces, they make certain angles with each other. Because of that, you can see some geometrical pattern in them, and you know that this is a crystal. So the most common examples which you see since childhood and the kids love are gems, diamonds. So those are the crystals that you become familiar with when you are very, very young. and that is the typical characteristic of a crystal. So now, based on the nature of bonding in crystalline solids, we can divide or classify the crystal structures into four kinds: ionic crystals, covalent crystals, molecular crystals, and metallic crystals. Let's define each of them and study their characteristics. So, what is an ionic crystal? So, in ionic crystals, the positively and negatively charged repeating units are arranged so that the potential energy of the ions in the lattice is minimum. Now, the ion of a given sign, whether positive or negative, is bonded through electrostatic forces of attraction or Coulombic forces of attraction to all the ions of the opposite sign. So, a positive ion will be bonded to a negative ion, or a negative ion will be bonded to a positive ion. Now, because of these strong electrostatic forces of attraction, they have certain characteristics. One is that they are very hard and brittle solids. Their melting points and boiling points are very high, because again I am saying this is due to the strong electrostatic forces of attraction. The vaporization energy of ionic substances is relatively higher, that is, they possess very, very small vapor pressure. Now, because they have strong electrostatic force of attraction between the ions, and the ions are not mobile in nature, therefore they are insulators in the solid state. But if you melt them or you dissolve them in aqueous solution, they become good conductors, because the ions then become mobile in nature. The packing of these ionic crystals depend upon the presence of the charged species which are there, and the difference in the size of the anions and the cations. Now let's take a look at the covalent crystal. In these crystals, the repeating units are atoms of the same or different kind bonded through electron pair bonds. The most common example is diamond, in which each carbon atom is surrounded by four carbon atoms tetrahedrally. So, because you have neutral atoms or molecules as the repeating units, because of that they have covalent bonds in them. But these covalent bonds are also strong. So, these atoms and bonds which are bonded through covalent bonds are bonded by strong and directional forces. Because of the strong forces which are there between these, they are hard and incompressible solids. They are extremely non-volatile and possess very, very high melting points. They are electrical insulators even above their melting points. They require high energies to separate them into constituent atoms. So, the two common examples that we study of covalent crystals are diamond and graphite. Now, let's study about molecular crystals. Molecular crystals are those in which the repeating units are atoms or molecules bonded by weak van der Waals type of forces. So, these are what? New atoms or molecules which are bonded by weak van der Waals type of forces. So, the general characteristics of these molecular crystals are, they are soft, compressible, and can be distorted easily. They are volatile in nature. Their melting points and boiling points are low, and they are electrical insulators, or they are very poor conductors of electricity. Now, coming to the metallic crystals. Now, these crystals are considered to be an arrangement of nuclei with free electrons moving in interstices, or you can imagine them to be made up of lattice points occupied by positive metal ions surrounded by a sea of mobile electrons. So you have metallic kernels or positive metal ions present on the lattice position, and there are mobile electrons which are present and free to move between the lattice points. Because they are metallic in nature, their characteristics are those of metals. So one, they have a silvery luster and high reflectivity. They can range from soft to very hard. They have very high tensile strength. Their thermal and electrical conductivity is high, or we can say they are the good conductors of electricity and heat. They are malleable and ductile. They can be drawn into wires, hammered into leaves, and bent without fracture. The bonding or electrons in the metals remain delocalized over the entire crystal, and because of that they are the good conductors. So that is one thing about the metallic crystal that you must try and remember. The idea of a lattice, the crystal lattice, was developed from the internal regularity of a crystal structure. So this is a crystal structure. Lattice is defined as an arrangement of geometrical points in a definite pattern in space, a highly ordered three-dimensional structure formed by atoms, molecules, or ions is called as a crystal lattice. If the constituents of a crystal are denoted by points, then a lattice may be regarded as an infinite set of points repeated regularly through the space. Now, a set of points which are repeated at regular intervals along a line is a one-dimensional lattice. Thus, a line is a lattice for a one-dimensional pattern. When a set of points are repeated regularly on a plane along any two coordinate axes, it is called as a two-dimensional lattice. The points in a two-dimensional lattice can be arranged in five and only five different ways. If the two-dimensional lattice is extended in three-dimensional, that is, the points are arranged in a regular, repeated manner along the three coordinate axes, x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, it results in a three-dimensional lattice, which is known as space lattice or a point lattice. Now, if the points in space lattice are replaced by the constituents of the crystal, which can be either atoms or molecules or ions, a crystal lattice is obtained. Thus, the parameters required to define the three types of lattice in the most general form will be discussed in the slide from now onwards. Now, you must understand, when we say lattice, it's nothing but a framework. So when you see a house which is building up, so you see those iron rods which are there, they're sometimes called as in Hindi sariya. So they make a framework, and within the framework for a house they put bricks, and that is how a house is made. That framework, which is made of iron rods, is nothing but a lattice. So a lattice gives a definition, a framework to a structure, and for a crystal, that is the lattice that we are talking about. And these lattice positions can be occupied by your atoms, molecules, ions, which are the constituents of the crystal. Now let's talk about the unit cell. The unit cell is the fundamental unit in a crystal. The repetitive arrangement of the unit cells in three dimension produces a crystal in a manner similar to way a wall is built from identical bricks. In other words, a unit cell is the smallest fundamental unit of a crystal, which when repeated in three dimension, or which on translational displacement in three dimension, will produce a crystal. Now, a unit cell which is chosen to represent the crystal may be quite different in size and shape from another unit cell, which may represent the crystal equally well. So you must remember that the main point here is that the unit cell may be, it should be the simplest representation, and when repeated in the three dimension should produce the crystal. Now let us look at ways to decide how we know which is a unit cell and whether it is a unit cell or not. Now this is, let's say, the representative example of a crystal lattice, where the red and the yellow balls are the constituent particles. They can be atoms, they can be molecules, they could be ions. Now if I want to decide which is a unit cell, there are certain criteria that it should fulfill. First, each unit cell should be identical to all the other unit cells that you can figure out in a lattice. Second, there shouldn't be no space between the unit cell. Now the origin or the place from where you decide to make a unit cell is up to you. It's arbitrary. The only criteria, the unit cell should be identical. And second, most criteria is that there should be no space between the unit cell. Let's see whether we are able to decide. Now, in this representative example, let us say I started from this red ball and went till this red ball. Now, this is my unit cell, which looks like this. It has yellow balls on the edges. These yellow balls on these edges. The red ball is on the corner and in the center. Do I get the same unit cell if I continue in this direction? Yes, I do. You see, when you move this direction, you get an identical unit cell. Even when you move downwards, you get an identical unit cell. You have the central ball, red ball in all the unit cells. You have yellow balls on the edges. You have red balls on the corners, and they are identical. So this is a two-dimensional representation. If we were to repeat it in the three dimension, then also we would get the same. So this is a unit cell and this is perfect. Let's move to the second example. Suppose I were to decide to take the yellow ball as the origin and I continue on this path. Do I get the same unit cell or the identical unit cell when I move in this direction? Yes, I do. I get yellow balls on the corners. I get yellow ball in the center, the red balls on the edges, and in all the unit cell. This unit cell is identical to this unit cell. This unit cell is also identical to this unit cell. This is also identical to the unit cell. So yes, this is a unit cell. Now let's take it another example. Let's say I decide to take the space between the constituent particles and decide to make a unit cell like this. Will it result in an identical unit cell if it is repeated in the three direction? And will I get the crystal lattice? You see, this unit cell is repeated here. And this is repeated here also. This is repeated here. You have yellow balls like this. You have red balls like this. And these are identical. And there is no space between the unit cell. So these are packed with no space between them. And they are identical in nature. Let's take another example. Now, if I were to take this as a unit cell, do I get identical? I don't think so. You can see you have a red ball's quarter part as a corner here, whereas the yellow ball's quarter part as a corner here. You have a yellow ball quarter part here and a red ball. So this unit cell is not identical to this one, and this one is not identical. So these unit cells, this is not a unit cell, because a unit cell has to be identical. That is, the unit cells, which are the smallest fundamental unit of a crystal lattice, they should be identical. That is, when repeated in all directions, they should be able to give you a crystal lattice. Let's take this example. Let's say this is the unit cell and this is another one that I have taken. Now this one is identical to this, but there is a problem. What is the problem? The unit cells are supposed to be packed together. There should not be any space. And in this unit cell and this unit cell, there is a space. And because there is a space, so this cannot be taken as a unit cell. Now, a unit cell looks like this. This is a parallelopiped. Now, this is the basic shape and this is how we describe a unit cell. A unit cell has three coordinate axes, x, y, and z. There are edge lengths along these three axes, small a, lowercase a, b, and c. So a is along x-axis, b along y-axis, and c along z-axis. The angle between a and b axis, the angle between b and c axis, and c and a axis are gamma, alpha, and beta. So the angle between a and b is gamma, which is opposite to z. The angle between b and c is alpha, which is opposite to a. The angle between a and c is beta, which is opposite to b. And these a, b, c, alpha, beta, gamma are together called as lattice parameters or unit cell parameters. Now, based on the relationship among these angles and the edge length, there are seven crystal systems that we know of: cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, rhombohedral, hexagonal, monoclinic, triclinic. We're going to take a look at them, but there are seven crystal systems. We are more interested in the cubic system. Now, why are we interested in the cubic system? Because it is simple, it has symmetry. You know what is a cube. So a cube will have the same value for all the three lattice parameters A, B, and C. And we know what is the geometry of a cube. So we are going to study cubic system, whereas there are other systems also available. You know, it's also easier to understand cubic system. So if you imagine yourself to be sitting in a cubical room, each wall of your room is called as a face. We're going to talk about this. Let's take a look at it. Each wall of a room is called as a face. So a face is a plane surface which is arranged in a definite pattern to give you a crystal. So the crystals are bounded by plane surfaces which are arranged in a definite pattern. So if you imagine yourself to be sitting in a cubical room, then each wall, including the floor and the ceiling of your room, is called as a face. And a cubical room will have six faces, four walls, the ceiling, and the floor. Now, what is an edge? So what is an edge? It is the line along the intersection of two adjacent faces. Now, so if you imagine yourself to be sitting in a room, then the places at which these walls meet, they are called as the edges. Each wall, where the place where two walls meet, is called as an edge. Now, then comes something called as form. All the faces of a crystal are said to constitute form. The external shape of the crystal that you see is called as a habit. So we've talked about some terms: face, edge, form, habit. Then comes the interfacial angle. Now, what is an interfacial angle? The angle between the lines perpendicular to any two adjacent faces of a crystal is called as an interfacial angle. I'm repeating, what is an interfacial angle? The angle between the lines which are perpendicular to any two adjacent faces. So you have two adjacent faces like this. Let's say these are the two adjacent faces, and you have two lines which are perpendicular to these faces, and the angle between those two lines is called as an interfacial angle. So with this, we have got some idea. Each point where the three faces of a cube or three walls in your room will meet is called as a corner. So we have talked about faces, we have talked about edges, we have talked about form, we have talked about habit, we have talked about interfacial angle, and now we are talking about corners. So a point where three faces of a cube meet is called as a corner. So these are certain terms. You will also have things like diagonals, phase diagonals. We're going to discuss them later, but just starting. Now, what is the relationship between them? So there is a mathematical relation, F plus C is equal to E plus 2, where F is the number of faces, C is the number of corners, and E is the number of edges. So F plus C, the number of faces plus number of corners, is equal to number of edges plus 2. So let's look at cube. In a cube, how many faces are there? There are 6 faces. How many corners are there? There are 8 corners. So 6 faces, 8 corners. How much does it come to be? 14. How many edges will you have? You will have 12 edges. So 12 plus 2 gives you 14. So the sum of faces plus corners is equal to edges plus 2. And this mathematical relationship will help you get some idea. Now let's take a look at what is a diagonal, a face diagonal, what is a body diagonal, because we are going to talk about it. So let me just give you a small snippet of this. So if you join the corners of a face diagonally, you get two face diagonals. So if I assume this is a face and I join the corners of a face diagonally, then I get two face diagonals in one face. You can also have body diagonals. By joining any two corners which are not in the same face, a body diagonal is obtained. Now, there are going to be 4 body diagonals in a cube. I will show it to you visually in the later slides. But let's just right now focus on the terms. We've talked about face, we've talked about corners, we've talked about edges, we've talked about habit, we've talked about form, interfacial angle, face center and body center. Now let's look at types of crystal systems. So let's start with that. Now we've talked about 7 crystal systems. Of the 7 crystal systems, some crystal systems may have one or more type of lattices depending on the number of lattice points. If there are lattice points only at the corners, can you see these? If there are lattice points only at the corners of a unit cell, it is called as a simple or primitive unit cell, normally represented as P. A cell which has lattice points at the corners as well as at the body center is called as a body centered unit cell or a body centered cell. A cell which has 8 lattice points at the 8 corners and 6 at the each of the 6 faces is called as a face centered unit cell. Can you see these? You have 8 corners all occupied by lattice points. And then you have face center. So this face has a center and it is occupied by a lattice point. Similarly, this face center is also occupied by a lattice point. Similarly, these two and front and back. So each of the faces is occupied by a lattice point. So each of the face center is occupied by a lattice point as well as the corner. So this is called as a face centered cell. Now, in the case of end face centered cell, you have corners occupied by the lattice point as well as the two faces which are opposite to each other being occupied by the lattice points. So you can see you have 8 corners and 2 more at the center of a pair of any 2 opposite faces. Here we have taken top and bottom. You can take any of the 2 opposite faces and this is called as an end face centered cell or end face centered unit cell. And the simple or primitive unit cell is normally represented by P. The end centered cell is represented by C. The body center is represented by I and face centered is represented by F. Now the face centered unit cell, the body centered unit cell and the end face centered unit cell are non-primitive cell because they have lattice points present at other position other than the corners. Now, based on the presence of lattice points in the 7 crystal systems that I had just talked about, cubic, orthorhombic, rhombohedral, tetragonal, triclinic, hexagonal, monoclinic, see these are the 7 crystal systems. Based on the presence of lattice points in the 7 crystal system, there can be 14 Brevi's lattices. Now, what is a Brevi's lattices? In 1850, M.A. Brevi showed that identical points can be arranged specially to produce 14 types of regular pattern. These 14 space lattices are known as Brevi's lattices. Please understand that there can be 28 possible unit cells, but only 14 exist. So those are arrangements in a given shape that violate even one symmetry element of that shape do not exist. So what is a symmetry element? We are going to discuss later. But just to give you an idea, what is a symmetry element? Symmetry element is when you have either a rotational axis, or you have a planar symmetry, or you have a center of inversion, then it is called a symmetry element. So there are actually 28 possible unit cells. Obviously, you have seven crystal systems, and if four of these unit cells are possible, so 7 fours are 28. 28 are there, but out of these, only 14 exist, because the rest 14 violate at least some symmetry element of that shape, right? So because these arrangements violate even one symmetry element of that shape, they do not exist. So let's take a look further. So these are the 14 Brevi's lattices which are possible, right? Now I have told you that we are more interested in the cubic system, but we have seven crystal system, and seven crystal system having these primitive and face centered and body centered kind of lattice unit cell. So these unit cells would have led to 28, but we have just said that some of them violate the symmetry conditions, and therefore only 14 of these exist. Now let's take a look at them in detail. So like I said, there are seven crystal system: cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, monoclinic, triclinic, trigonal, hexagonal. And how did we decide these? These are depending upon the lattice parameters that we had discussed: A, B, C, and alpha, beta, and gamma. So if A, B, and C are equal, and alpha, beta, gamma is also equal to 90, and they are equal to each other, then we have a cubic system. And within the cubic system, you will have primitive, you have body-centered, and you will have face-centered variation. No end face-centered, right? Okay. In the tetragonal, which has A is equal to B, not equal to C, alpha, beta, gamma all equal to 90 degree, you can have primitive and body-centered. In the case of orthorhombic, in which A, B, and C are not equal, alpha, beta, and gamma are equal and equal to 90 degree, you can have all four kinds. You can have primitive, body-centered, face-centered, and centered, and face-centered. Similarly, in the case of monoclinic, which has A, B, C not equal to each other, alpha, beta, gamma equal to 90, but not alpha, beta equal to 90 and not equal to gamma, you can have primitive and end-centered. In the case of triclinic, A, B, and C are not equal. Alpha, beta, gamma are not equal to each other and not equal to 90 also. You can only have primitive. In the case of trigonal, you have A, B, and C equal. Alpha, beta, gamma equal, but not equal to 90. You can still have only primitive. In the case of hexagonal, you have A and B equal, not equal to C. And you have alpha, beta equal to 90, gamma equal to 120. You can still have primitive. So if you count all these, this will come out to be 14. We are more interested in cubic system, but these are the seven crystal system. And within the seven crystal system, you have 14 Brevi's lattices, right? So let's take a look at the various examples of these crystal system. So for a cubic crystal system, you have NaCl, KCl, CaF2. For the orthorhombic, you have barium sulfate, potassium nitrate, MgSiO3, potassium sulfate, cadmium sulfate. Similarly, tetragonal, you will have SnO2, TiO2, ZrSiO4. Monoclinic, you can have calcium sulfate, monoclinic sulfur. Triclinic, you can have copper sulfate with 5 molecules of hydration, so pentahydrate, NaHSO4, NH3PO3. Hexagonal, you can have PbI2, Mg, cadmium, zinc, ZnO. Rhombohedral or trigonal, you will have graphite, ICL, Al2O3, calcite. So these are the various examples I hear in your syllabus as of undergraduate. You need to study only about the cubic system in detail, right? Let us try and recall what we have learned in the 12th standard. We had calculated number of atoms per unit cell in a cubic lattice. This is needed because we'll be using it in numericals, and it's also important for our understanding. So just some time spent on calculation of number of atoms, and it will also increase our understanding. So just let's take a look at it. In the simple cubic unit cell, you have a unit cell in which the corners are occupied by lattice points or the constituent particles. Now, what is the number of atom in this? So let's just see. Each corner is contributing only 1 by 8 to the present unit cell because it's part of 8 other unit cells. So this ball that you see, or this ball, is actually part of 8 other unit cells. And because it is part of 8 other unit cells, therefore to this unit cell, it is contributing only 1 by 8. So if each of these balls contributes only 1 by 8 to the unit cell, and there are 8 of these balls, therefore the number of these balls will be equal to 1. Now I am calling them balls, but they are actually what? Atoms or lattice points or the constituent particles. So number of atoms per unit cell in a simple cubic unit cell will be equal to 8 into 1 by 8, which is equal to 1. Now this is an example of polonium. So polonium has simple cubic unit cell. Now let's take a look at the body-centered cubic unit cell. I did tell you in the body-centered cubic unit cell, you have the corners occupied by the constituent particles or atoms or molecules or ions. And also the center of the unit cell is occupied by atom, molecule or ion or the constituent particle, whatever we may call. Now this 8 corner plus 1 body center, what is the contribution? Now we've already said that the corners are only contributing 1 by 8 to each unit cell. But this particle, which is present in the center of the body, is contributing wholly to the unit cell. So let us now try and calculate the number of atoms. So there are 8 corners, 8 into 1 by 8, because each corner is contributing 1 by 8. And then the body center is contributing wholly to it. So 1 body center into 1. So 1 into 1. So you get 2. And this is an example of cesium chloride and cesium bromide. So CaCl and CsBr have a body-centered cubic unit cell. Let's take a look at face-centered cubic unit cell. In the face-centered cubic unit cell, we have talked about it. In the face-centered cubic unit cell, we've talked about it. You have lattice points present at the corners and also present on the 6 faces of the cubic unit cell. Now just see. So you have 8 corners and 6 faces. So if you're imagining yourself to be sitting in a room which is cubical in nature, then all the walls are the 6 faces, including the floor and the ceiling. And they have, on the center of each of these faces is occupied by a lattice point. Also the corner. So 8 corners, each contributing 1 by 8. And there are 6 faces. And the face is part of 2 unit cells. 8 corners are contributing 1 by 8 to a unit cell, and the faces are contributing 1 by 2 to a unit cell, because you know, if this is one face of one unit cell, this is the face of other unit. So the ball which is present in the center of this face is part of only 2 unit cells, the below one and the top one. So each face centered lattice point is contributing only 1 by 2. So number of atoms in the unit cell will be equal to 8 into 1 by 8 plus 6 into 1 by 2, and you get 4. Now the examples are sodium chloride, sodium fluoride, potassium bromide and magnesium oxide. Let's take a look at end phase centered unit cell. So in the end phase centered unit cell, you have eight corners occupied by the lattice points and any two opposite faces center being occupied by the lattice points. So in this case, you can see there are eight corners and these are the two opposite faces under consideration. So number of atoms per unit cell will be 8 into 1 by 8 because corners are contributing 1 by 8. The faces are contributing 1 by 2. So 8 into 1 by 8 plus 2 into 1 by 2 and we get 2 atoms in a unit cell. Now let's take a look at what is the coordination number. So the Brevi's lattice points closest to a given point are the nearest neighbors. So the nearest neighbors, the number of nearest neighbors to a given point is called as a coordination number. So a simple cubic cell, you please try and recall from your 12th standard. We are not going to go into detail because it's already been done in your 12th standard. A simple cubic unit cell has a coordination number of 6. A body-centered cubic unit cell has a coordination number of 8. And a face-centered cubic unit cell has a coordination number of 12. Now, let's try and use our knowledge that we have done till now and also recall our previous knowledge from the 12th standard and use it to solve certain small numericals just to give us a better understanding. So the first is a compound formed by elements A and B has a cubic structure in which A atoms are at the corners of a cube and B atoms are the face center. Derive the formula. So A are only at the corners and B are only at the face center. So let's see. Because A are present at the eight corners, so the number of atoms in the unit cell will be equal to 8 into 1 by 8, so 1. B is present at the face center. Now there are how many faces? 6 faces. So number of atoms of B in this unit cell will be equal to 6 into 1 by 2, which is 3. So the formula of the compound will be equal to AB3. Very simple numerical. Let's take a look at another numerical. A cubic solid is made of two elements P and Q. Atoms of Q are at the corners of the cube and P at the body center. What is the formula of the compound? What are the coordination numbers of P and Q? Now, since Q atoms are present at the corners of the cube, how many Q atoms are going to be there? You have 8 corners. Each corner contribution is 1 by 8. So you will have 1 atom of Q. Now, about the atoms of P. Now, there is only one atom of P present in the body center and its contribution is totally 1. So, 1 into 1, you get 1. So, the ratio and the formula of the compound is PQ. The ratio will be 1 is to 1 and the formula of the compound is going to be PQ. As for the coordination number, the coordination number for each P and Q is going to be 8. Now, let's take a look at atomic packing factor. So, what is an atomic packing factor? Atomic packing factor is the sum of the volume of the spheres of all the atoms within a unit cell divided by a unit cell volume. In other words, you take the sum of the volume of each of the atom and divide it by the total volume of the unit cell. It's also like a packing efficiency. If you express it in fractions, it is atomic packing factor. If you express it in terms of percentage, then you call it packing efficiency. But it's one and the same thing. You are taking the sum of the volume of all the atoms and divided it by the volume of the unit cell. Now let's see. Let's take an example of simple cubic. So this is a figure for a simple cubic unit cell. Now just see, this is the edge length and within the unit cell you have 8 spheres. Each of these spheres is contributing 1 by 8 as we have already said and therefore there will be how many atoms in all? 8 into 1 by 8, 1. Now just see, if this is the edge length, this is the edge length, and you have these two spheres, then R, which is the radius of one of the spheres, is actually the half of the edge length. So R is equal to 0.5 a. Now that's the relationship between the radius and the edge length of a simple cubic. That is, R, which is the radius of the sphere, is equal to the half of the edge length a. Now let's find out the atomic packing factor. What is the atomic packing factor? Number of atoms into volume of each atom divided by the total volume of the unit cell. Now how many atoms are there in simple cubic? We just found 8 into 1 by 8, that is 1. So there is 1 atom per unit cell. Now what is its volume? We know that the volume is equal to 4 by 3 pi r cube. So here r is equal to what? 0.5 a. So 4 by 3 pi into 0.5 a whole cube. This is the volume of one atom, right? This is the volume of one atom. And this, when multiplied by 1, gives you the volume of the all the atoms in the unit cell. Now you divide it by the volume of the unit cell and you will get the packing efficiency or the simple cubic cell's atomic packing factor. It is equal to 0.52, right? Now let's take a look at the body-centered cubic unit cell. In the body-centered cubic unit cell, you have 8 corners being occupied by these spheres. Also, in the center, you have 1 atom, and this is how they are packed. Now let's try and see how this relationship goes. I was talking about the body diagonal. So a body diagonal is when you go from one corner to the other corner. So just see, this is the body diagonal. Now if this is the body diagonal, let's try and find out the relationship. Now this is edge length. We have already talked about it. This is equal to A. This will also be equal to A. This will also be equal to A. So the edges are equal to A. Now let's try and find out the relationship between the thing. So now just see, this line that you see is actually the face diagonal. This is actually the face diagonal. So now this face diagonal is actually a hypotenuse for this right angle triangle, where the base and the perpendicular are both equal to A, and the hypotenuse therefore will be equal to root 2A. So this face diagonal is equal to root 2A because this is equal to A and this is equal to A. Now this body diagonal, we want to find out its length. This face diagonal was equal to root 2A. This is equal to A. Now just see here. You have one corner, then you have other corner, and in the middle you have a body-centered atom. And here you have A, here you have root 2A. So when you find out the value of the hypotenuse, perpendicular and base using, you will get this equal to root 3A, right? Now this root 3A is actually the sum of radius of this sphere plus diameter of this sphere plus radius of this sphere. So 4R is equal to root 3A. So this is the relationship between the radius and the edge length of a body-centered cubic unit cell. I'm repeating, how do we go about doing it? You have edge length A here. And now this is a face. Let's say this is the face. You know the edge length, right? You have to find out the face diagonal. So this is the face diagonal. This is the face diagonal. So this is A. This is A. And if you want to find out the hypotenuse, so A square plus A square is equal to hypotenuse square. So hypotenuse is equal to root 2A. So you get the face diagonal value equal to root 2A. Now you want to find out the value of body diagonal. So body diagonal is actually equal to root 2a whole square plus a square. And then when you solve it, you get root 3a equal to the body diagonal. Now this body diagonal is actually equal to 4R, because this is R, this is R, and this is equal to 2R. So 4R is equal to root 3M. Now let's try and find out the atomic packing factor or packing efficiency. Now just see, how many atoms are there in the body centered cubic unit cell? It is 2. So 2. Now 4 by 3 pi R cube. Now instead of R, you substitute root 3A upon 4. So 4 by 3 pi root 3A upon 4 whole cube divided by A cube, and you get that the packing efficiency is equal to 0.68. Atomic packing factor is 0.68. Packing efficiency will be in the percentage, so 68%. Now what was there for body simple cubic? You had 52%. Here you have 68%. Let's see for face centered cubic. Now this is the structure of the face centered cubic unit cell. You have 8 corners occupied and you have faces center occupied by the atomic sphere. Now just see, this face center is contributing only half. The corners are contributing only 1 by 8. So how many atoms will be there? 8 into 1 by 8 plus how many faces? 6. 6 into 1 by 2, which is equal to 4. So there are 4 atoms in a face-centered cubic unit cell. Now try and find out the relationship between the 4R and root 2A. So this relationship, you've already probably derived it in your 12th standard and used it earlier. But anyways, so 4R is equal to root 2A is the relationship between the radius of each sphere and the edge length A. So 4R is equal to root 2A. Now let's try and find out the atomic packing factor. Now what is atomic packing factor? Number of atoms into volume of each atom divided by the volume of the unit cell. So what is the number of atoms we just calculated? It is equal to 4. Now what about the volume of each sphere? 4 by 3 pi r cube. Now what is R equal to? R is equal to root 2a upon 4, which is equal to root 2a by 4 whole cube. So when you substitute, so 4 into 4 by 3 into pi into root 2a upon 4 whole cube divided by a cube. So when you solve this, you get the value as 0.74. So the atomic packing factor in the case of simple cubic was 0.52. Body centered, it was 0.68. And in the case of face centered cubic unit cell, it is 0.74. This is a factor or a fraction. You can convert it into the percentage by just multiplying with 100, and that will give you the packing efficiency. So this packing or this kind of packing is the best kind of packing, or it is the maximum achievable atomic packing factor. So best packing for any crystal would be that of face-centered cubic. Now let's see the comparison of these crystal structures. So this in the simple cubic, the coordination number is 6, the packing factor is 0.52. In the case of body-centered cubic, coordination number is 8, packing factor is 0.68. In the face-centered cubic, packing factor is 0.4 and the coordination number is 12. In the hexagonal close packing, see these are identical. Hexagonal close packing, coordination number 12, packing factor 0.74. Now, please understand, it is to be very clear, the face-centered cubic and hexagonal close pack is the same kind of packing with the same packing efficiency and the same coordination number, right? Okay. So let's just take a look at two numericals, very small, simple numerical. Barium has a radius of 224 picometers and crystallizes in a body-centered cubic structure. What is the edge length of the unit cell? So radius is given as 224 picometer and it is a body-centered cubic unit structure. You know what is the relationship? The relationship between the edge length and the radius is given by r is equal to root 3a upon 4. You just substitute the values of r and you can get the value of a. So a is equal to r into 4 upon root 3, which is equal to 224 into 4 by 1.7320. So you get 517.3 picometer as the edge length of a system of barium. Similarly, let's take a look at the numerical on aluminium. Aluminium crystallizes in the cubic closed packing. Please understand, cubic closed packing is same as face-centered cubic. So, aluminium crystallizes in cubic closed packed structure. Its metallic radius is 125 picometer. What is the edge length of the unit cell? Now, R is equal to 125 picometer. We know what is the relationship between R and A. For face centered, R is equal to A upon 2 root 2, right? Now, we want to find out the value of A. So, A is equal to R into 2 into root 2. We just substitute the value and we get 353.5. So, with this, we have actually finished with the introduction on solid state. This is actually basically a recall of what you have already done in your 12th standard. So today we discussed actually solids, what is crystallography, what are the various kinds of crystal structures. We talked about unit cell, what are the various parameters that are there. We also talked about the Bruvius lattice, how that division has and classification has taken place. Then we tried and calculate the number of atoms per unit cell along with the packing efficiency. So with this, we have finished with the introduction of solid state, and we will continue with the solid state in the next lecture also.